Glory be to God and honor. Almighty God, we thank you for planting in us the seed of your word. By your Holy Spirit, help us to receive it with joy and bring forth fruits in faith and hope and love through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Today we celebrate the eighth Sunday after the Festival of Pentecost. Our first lesson is recorded for us in the Old Testament book of Amos, reading from the seventh chapter. Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent a message to Jeroboam, king of Israel. Amos is raising a conspiracy against you in the very heart of Israel. The land cannot bear all his words, for this is what Amos is saying. Jeroboam will die by the sword, and Israel will surely go into exile, away from their native land. Then Amaziah said to Amos, "Get out, you seer. Go back to the land of Judah. Earn your bread there and do your prophesying there. Don't prophesy anymore at Bethel, because this is the king's sanctuary and the temple of the kingdom." Amos answered Amaziah, "I was neither a prophet nor a prophet's son, but I was a shepherd, and I also took care of sycamore fig trees. But the Lord took me from tending the flock and said to me, 'Go prophesy to my people Israel.'" The word of the Lord. I'd like you to chant with me now Psalm 78, found on page 95. Praise be to the God and Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him we have redemption, through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. And he made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times will have reached their fulfillment, to bring all things in heaven and on earth together under one head, even Christ. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were first to hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory. The word of the Lord. Hallelujah. The word is very near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart, so you may obey it. Hallelujah. Gospel of St. Mark, the 6th chapter, beginning at the 7th verse. Calling the 12 to him, he sent them out two by two and gave them authority over evil spirits. These were his instructions. Take nothing for the journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in your belts. Wear sandals, but not an extra tunic. Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave that town. And if any place will not welcome you or listen to you, shake the dust off from your feet when you leave as a testimony against them. They went out and preached that people should repent. They drove out many demons and anointed many sick people with oil and healed them. The Gospel of our Lord. Let us unite with Christians the world over and confess the faith that we have in our God this morning according to the words of the Nicene Creed on page 8. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Thank you.
grace, mercy, and peace are yours from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. The word of God for our consideration this morning is taken from Psalm 145. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food at the proper time. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. This is the word of our God. Dear Christian friends, I'd like to ask you a question this morning. Do you think that the Lord's Prayer is more fitting at a wedding or a funeral? Is it more fitting at the bedside of a servant of the Lord who is about to enter glory, or at the cradle of a young child? If you're saying, I'm not sure about the answer, I would say that's a good answer. Because this prayer that the Lord has given us to pray, and that we know so well, is a prayer that touches every aspect of our lives. There is nothing that it does not address. There's so much that's contained in the words of this prayer. In it, we ask for great things. We ask that God's name be kept holy among us, and that we would keep it holy. We ask that His kingdom would come, not only to us, but to others as well, the mission work that we seek to do. We ask for grand and glorious things. And then we also ask for our daily ration of bread. Now, as you know, we are in the middle of a sermon series on the Lord's Prayer. And today, we come to that little petition, the one where Jesus tells us to go to God and to ask for our daily bread. Of all the sentences of this prayer, doesn't this one seem to be maybe the most trite and trivial? But that is what God tells us to do. In the fourth petition of the Lord's Prayer, we pray, give us this day our daily bread. Now, what's unique, of course, about this petition is that this is the only petition that deals with our physical needs. Of the seven petitions, six of them are spiritual in nature. But this, the fourth petition, deals with the needs that we have. We pray for all of these unbelievable, wonderful things. Forgiveness, that we'd live a life worthy to our God. But our Lord is also concerned about our daily physical needs as well. Where the rubber meets the road for us, as we might say. Everyday concerns that we might have. Like, where am I going to come up with enough money to pay that bill? Or, will my furnace make another heating season? Or, what about the test that the doctor is going to call me about? What about the health concerns, the surgery that I'm undergoing? How am I ever going to find somebody to spend the rest of my life with? The right person? How am I going to mend the relationships that seem to be ripping apart from me right now? And the people that I love? You know, our earthly concerns are no small matter to us, are they? And you know what? They're no small matter to your God either. Today, we'll look at the fourth petition, the prayer through the psalm writer who wrote, Lord, we look to you. We look to you for all things, and we look to you with all trust. Back in the Old Testament, the people of Israel had a unique mannerism, if you will, a posture when they prayed. You think of what we're accustomed to now. Many times we fold our hands, we maybe bow our heads, maybe close our eyes. But in the Old Testament, they would pray with their hands outstretched, looking up to heaven, understanding that all the blessings that we receive come from God. And our hands are out there receiving each and every one of those blessings that God freely gives to us. In fact, our text tells us that every living thing has to look to God, whether they know it or not. There are many that think, I have what I have because I got it. I earned it. I deserved it. My blood, sweat, tears, my good business skills, whatever it might be. And there are others that recognize, like you and I, that all our blessings come to us from God Himself. Yeah, a person may think that they are the ones that are responsible for it, but they are not. The psalmist writes, "The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food at the proper time." As believers, we understand. As believers, we see that we have a gracious God, and we accept that invitation that He offers to us. Give us this day our daily bread. But we might ask, well, what is included in daily bread? Well, Luther sums it up really well in the explanation that we see in our catechism. But really, it boils down to two things that we are asking for when we pray, give us this day our daily bread. And one is for all the things that contribute to our daily health, our daily life, our daily existence. And the other is a prayer against anything that might hinder our health, our daily existence, the things that come to us from God. What do you think about it? Jesus is asking us, telling us to pray for an awful lot, isn't He? Just think, if you had to make a list of all the things that affect you every day or your loved ones in their lives, that list would be awfully long. But that's a list that our Father wants us to take to Him, and He promises to lovingly answer for us. We'd have to include a lot of things in that list, wouldn't we? We'd have to include food, drink, house, clothing, the things that we need for our daily existence. We'd also should be including the government for the stability, security, protection, peace, and the like. There are a million things that we could pray for, from the ozone layer to the city sewer system. None of them are insignificant, and all of them are blessings to us from God. That is why He says, come to Me and pray, give us this day our daily bread. And if there are any enemies, if there's anything that would try to foil the plot against Me, against what You want us to have, Lord, foil that plot. Lord, we look to You for all things, and we look to You with all trust. How important to know that Jesus tells us to ask for daily bread, right? Doesn't say, give us this week our weekly bread, or month, daily. Each and every day, He wants us to go to Him confident that He will give us what we need today, and we go to Him tomorrow, confident that He will give us what we need tomorrow, until finally He gives us a home in glory. He opens His hand. He satisfies the desire of every living thing. Daily bread. Daily means trusting the Lord enough today and trusting Him tomorrow as well. Even as Christians, we know that's a little bit difficult at times, don't we? We sometimes wonder if we are going to have enough. And when we consider all of the material blessings that we have, especially living in this nation that we live in, sometimes a couple of problems can happen, I believe. One is worry, maybe worry that we're not going to have all those blessings, all the things we think we need, and those things that we do need. And the other is materialism, putting our confidence and trust sometimes in those earthly blessings more than we do in the one that gives us those blessings. Yeah, materialism, paying too much attention to the gifts and not enough attention to the giver. So as long as we're looking at this part of the Lord's Prayer, we might consider both of these problems. First, what about worry? You know, this might be one that affects everybody. Many temptations, I think, in life, we learn how to deal with better the older we get. But why do I have a feeling that worry might be one that actually bothers us more the older we get? Is it because we have more people whose lives we're worried about and concerned for? Not only ourselves, maybe our spouse, but now our children, now maybe grandchildren. As the older we get, the more concerned we are about our health, our finances, where we're going to end up. The Lord says, I will take care of you. I will be there for you through everything. The more time we have on our hands, the more we might worry. Yet Jesus speaks so clearly to us. Don't worry. Your heavenly Father, your Father in heaven knows that you need things even before you ask for them. Seek first his kingdom, and all these things will be given to you as well. Or what about the Apostle Paul when he says, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also along with him graciously give us all things? We have a God who loved us enough to send and sacrifice his son. Do you think he doesn't know enough or can't or wouldn't care enough to take care of these things that we consider daily bread? Look to the Lord with all trust. And then there's that problem of materialism. Even non-Christian observers see where people are headed today. The desire isn't for family. It isn't for moral and religious values. Many times it's for the almighty dollar. To get more, to have more, to be able to do more. So how do we keep everything in perspective? I have a feeling that most of us have probably had those thoughts before. The pursuit of material wealth over even our faith, over spreading the gospel message. The Lord promises to satisfy the desire of every living thing when we look to him with that trust. And when we find ourselves loving and trusting our money or possessions more than loving and trusting the one who gave them to us, maybe that's time for a little adjustment, huh? That'll be next week's petition, by the way. Forgive us our trespasses. For today, Jesus teaches us to pray, give us this day our daily bread. Lord, we look to you for all things with complete trust. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food at the proper time. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. Amen. Now may the peace of God that transcends all understanding hearts and minds and faith in Christ Jesus. Thank you. Heavenly Father, forgive our sins and cleanse our gifts of any taint of selfishness. If our love for you begins to grow cold, give us a richer measure of the Holy Spirit to increase our faith, for it's faith that works through love. Then our offerings will also increase in time, talents, and treasures. We ask this in Jesus' name, for whose sake we desire and abound all the more in your gracious love. We ask this in his name. Rise for prayer. Heavenly Father, though you are exalted over heaven and earth, nevertheless, you have mercy and compassion upon the lowly. Therefore, we come to you confidently with all our needs, trusting you to supply them. We come to you for food, clothing, shelter, good health, steady employment, protection, and all other things that we require. And because we still have our sinful flesh, we confess that we are in danger of desiring more than is sufficient or of striving for things that are not good for us. We therefore leave the final selection of all your earthly blessings to your wisdom and holy will. Father, we know that you have forgiven all our sins and supplied all our needs. Therefore, it's unto you that we raise our voice in praise and prayer. Heavenly Father, we also thank you for the eternal life that you have given to Betty Buck, the mother of Diane Folkinson, as you called her to your side this past week. So Lord, we come to you now as a body united under Christ, our good shepherd. We ask that you grant peace and comfort to all who mourn the passing our sister. Give them the peace and comfort that only you can give. The comfort of knowing that those who fall asleep in your name here on earth will awaken with you to spend eternity in heaven praising you. Grant the strength that they need to be able to see your will in what has happened and to look to your word for needed comfort and assurance. We ask all this in your name. It's in your name that we now join and pray the prayer you've taught us. Our
Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious. The Lord look on you with his favor and give you his peace.
Amen.
You may be seated as we sing the closing two verses of hymn number 410, printed on your insert page with the scripture.
Thank you.
morning and welcome to all of you. Just one announcement reminder, and that is we are planning to have our vacation Bible school tomorrow through Thursday. So hopefully we'll have some children showing up for that. There's a few that have registered, and we're excited about being able to offer that again this year as well. Have a wonderful, blessed rest of the day.